Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this chance that we can come in thy house and study thy word, and that we can hear the word of the Lord speak. We pray, Father, that each one's come this way today. We pray a special blessing on each one of them. We pray to be Brother Freeman as he brings a message this morning. Father, you just lift him up. We pray that you be with our families every day. Lead us and guide us and forgive us most all. We feel it in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. It's good to see everybody that's here this morning. If you would, please stand as we continue on with our call to worship. We'll sing, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High.
Save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
And you may be seated.
Well, I hope you can say that you are glad he came to save you this morning. Good morning, Hillcrest Baptist Church. It is good to be here this morning. Good to see all your smiling faces here this morning. We want to welcome you to Hillcrest. I just have a few announcements for you this morning. First of all, tomorrow, before I forget, because it's not on the bulletin, but I did jot it down, but I'll forget it anyway. Tomorrow, we're trying to get some people who are available at 8 a.m. You can come a little bit later, but we are going to disassemble the garage that's out there that's kind of leaning a little bit, and so we're going to disassemble that before we have some storms coming up on Wednesday, and so we want to make sure that that doesn't take loft and end up in the middle of Dover Road or somewhere. So if you are available and you have a drill, cordless drill, and a 5/16, is that what it was, Richard? 5/16 bit. If you don't, come on up and we'll find something to disassemble that thing, but we need some help doing that, please, tomorrow. And you can see Ron Erb if you have any questions about that. Other announcements this morning. We got a lot going on. Our Easter egg hunt is coming up pretty quickly on March 30th. Of course, that's one of our largest outreaches, and so start spreading the news. It's in your bulletin, the times and all that, but wherever you are, make sure you're telling people that we have a fantastic spring activity in that Easter egg hunt. Youth, we're going to YEC. When is that? March 22nd and 23rd. If you have not told me that you are going, or Hannah that you are going yet, please do so so that we can get our accommodations taken care of. And it is a wonderful time. It's Youth Evangelism Conference. There's a loud concert and great speakers for that. And we also have coming up Fuge. This year for Fuge, we are going down to Mobile, Alabama. I've already got a list of about 15 or 16 young people that are going. So be praying for them. I'm going to send out a list here in the next couple of weeks of those students who are going, but be praying for them. There's also financial needs for some of those young people so that we can send them on that mission trip. And so if you'd like to do that, just write a check, earmark it youth or Fuge, and we will make sure that gets in the right place. The GAs are continuing their mission project through the month of March. They're collecting items for the Baptist Friendship House in New Orleans. There's a list out on the table, out in the foyer. Yep, Ms. Pam has it right there out in the foyer. Grab one of those lists, go shop, buy some stuff, and bring it back up here. If you don't want to do that, again, you can write a check or cash in an envelope earmarked GA mission trip. What else do we got going on? Women on Mission, Sunday, March 3rd. At 5 p.m., the theme is going to be Pray with Fervency. If ever there's a need to pray with fervency, it is now. And so Women on Mission would like to invite all women to that activity as well. And I think that is all the announcements that I have this morning. Again, we want to welcome you to Hillcrest, and we're going to welcome visitors. Thank you for choosing to come to Hillcrest this morning. We want to welcome you, and we're going to do that. We're going to stand up. We're going to sing, and as we sing, we're going to walk and shake hands.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined us with Jesus as we travel this out. For I'm part of the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined us with Jesus as we travel this out. For I'm part of the family of God.
Eight children, come on down. Come on down. I'm thinking some of you don't know my name, maybe. I'm Miss Kathy. So when you see me in the hall, you say, "Hey, Miss Kathy," and I'll say, "Hey, you," because some of you I don't know, and I want you to tell me your name, and we'll meet each other, and then we'll know more about each other. Did you know that there are people in this church, look out there, every single one of them, and look at each other, every single one of them God has given gifts and talents. He made you perfectly. He made you exactly with everything you needed to serve Him. Me too. I think sometimes when we think, and we talk about spiritual gifts in the Bible, this goes for you people too. Samuel. Samuel is so talented. You know Mr. Samuel who plays the piano? And he writes, and he's an excellent artist. And I think of that sometimes when I think of gifts and talents, don't you? Our minds go right to it. Well, Did you know that God uses all of our talents, not just the ones that fit easy on a stage? I don't know if she's in here, but do you guys know Miss Teresa? Miss Teresa Barra? She's probably in the nursery hall right now, I bet. So maybe she can hear me. But she is the one who watches our, who takes care of our books. That means our money. As money comes in and goes out, she's got some math skills, and God has allowed her to have that skill, and she uses it for the church in that way. And we so need that, right? Miss Anita's back there. Wave your hand, Miss Anita. See the hand up there? She used to do that job for many years. And then Miss Teresa used it. So God has used math as a gift for his church. Do you know Mr. Clarence? Mr. Clarence, wave your hand. He's over there. Did you know that he does a lot to take care of our church? He sets things up. He moves tables and chairs and prepares things so that we come here, they are well taken care of, that the lights are off, just all sorts of things that he does. Now, would you think about that being a talent or a gift? I'm here to tell you it is. And he's been gracious enough that he's allowing God to use that gift. I've never told Mr. Clarence this, so I'm going to tell it in front of everybody, but when we were getting ready to build that building over there, we had a service, and we were talking about it was going to take all of us to be able to build that building. And I'll never forget, Mr. Clarence closed us in prayer that night, and you know what he said in his prayer? He said, "I don't have much, Lord, but if there's a ditch that needs digging, I've got a shovel. And I'll be there." Makes me tear up right now, though. What a testimony. Mr. Clarence is like, "I've got what I've got, and I'll bring it to your house, God." What a blessing. Each of you have one of those things. And as you grow up, you'll learn more about what you're good at. And when it's time, and when you have an opportunity, make sure you're using it for the Lord, okay? Oh, there's some people apparently going to help with some construction. I do not have that skill. It's okay, though, because there's other people in the church that will come help take care of the building that we need taken care of. I could come, and I could tell them how they're doing it wrong while they're doing it. But I'm not sure that's very helpful. There are other people, though, that know exactly how to do that sitting in here, and they'll take care of that because God brought us together with all the right gifts and all the right time. Well, all right, who's got it? What's the name of the verse for memorizing? Who knows the scripture? I shall not want. He leads me by green pastures, and yes, and beside still waters. And it's Psalm 23. You ready to do the next part? All right, here we go. He restores my soul. Say that. He restores my soul. Say it again. Say it one more time. You know what that means? When you're tired from working, serving, giving, maybe tired of being mistreated. He restores our soul, our insides. He refreshes us. We get to lie down by green pastures. He leads us by still waters. And then he restores our soul. And he leads us in path. Oh, that's a lot of words. Let's just stop with he restores our soul today. All right, from the beginning, you ready? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down. He leads me beside still water. He restores my soul. Restores my soul. And that's Psalm 23. All right. We're going to pray. And then if you're old enough for children's worship, you go to children's worship. See Miss Hannah back there? She's got a gift. It's a gift with working with children. That's you. And so some of you will go back there and the others go back to your seats. And if I see you in the hall and say, "Give it to me, Psalm 23, be ready. All right. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for these precious ones right here, and I thank you for these precious ones in the pew. Lord, you brought us all here to this church for a reason, and you've given us purpose, and you've given us gifts, and Lord, I just pray that you'll restore our soul so that we are ready to serve you in the way that you would have. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. wonderful, you wonderful. You did. You weren't going to say a word, were you? Oh, look, and they're Sour Patch Kids. You could have been sour, but you were nice. You could have been sour. You are tall. There you go. You're welcome.
And you may remain seated as we continue on with number 301, I Am Resolved, 301.
Sense of glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to follow the Savior, faithful and true each day. In what he saith, to what he willeth, he is the living way.
Please stand as we continue on with Come All Christians Be Committed.
Come All Christians Be Committed to the service of the Lord. Make your lives for Him more fitted. Tune your hearts with one accord. Coming to His courts with gladness, each His sacred vows renew. Turn away from sin and sadness, be transformed with life anew. Tithes and offerings with you bring. In your work with Him find favor, and with joy His praises sing. Come in praise and adoration, all who and love will you receive. For story till the world is named as heard.
Till
the world is named as heard.
And you may be seated.
16, there you go. You know, as my wife often says, you need a lot of help, Roger. You really need a lot of help. Can any of you wives identify with that? Can you hear me now, Bobby? Yeah, you sit on the front row, you can always hear. But I've noticed, thank you, there we go. Kathy, that's so you could hear me compliment you. You did a great job with that. And mentioning the various members of the body of Christ, and thank you for doing that. And maybe when you get through Psalm 23, a few weeks, we'll rotate out. But thank you so much for doing such a great job. This is not part of the sermon, so don't start timing. I'm going to go up there and preach in a minute. But last week, you paid me a great honor by electing or voting to call me as interim pastor. And I want you to know how seriously I take that. And I've asked the deacons to lay their hands on me and Steve to pray over me before the sermon, just for a few moments. 55 years ago this fall, I first became the pastor of a Baptist church. You can do the math on all that. 1969. How many decades have I touched? God has allowed me to live and touch. That's okay. That was when I was married, too. You could be my son. But 9 months later. But God is good. Hey, I praise God for every day. This is a testimony, is what it is. Every morning when I get up, I quote Psalm 103, 1 through 5. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Who forgiveth all thy iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. And one of the good things God is giving me is allowing me to still preach the gospel. I love to preach the Word of God, and I love to go verse by verse through the Word of God. I wanted to say to you that I feel a call to be interim pastor as much as I've ever felt a call to be any other churches I've ever served. And I want you to pray for me, please. The main thing is to be led 100% by the Holy Spirit. Everything I do, everything I say, everything I preach, everything I think, anything at all, totally be from the Holy Spirit. So, along with Acts 13, where they laid hands on Paul and Silas before that missionary journey, Paul and Silas, Barnabas was with them earlier. Steve, I'm going to ask you to come as deacon chairman to the mic and lead in a prayer, just a prayer of the Holy Spirit to be upon me and our church. There's a sweet relationship between pastor and people. I've loved that through the years. I've watched it with other pastors and people. It's always been such a blessing. And pray for me to do God's will. So if deacons, if you'd come lay hands on me, and Steve, if you say a prayer, then we'll have the sermon. Just lay hands on me wherever you want.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that I have to come before you and pray to you, Father. And in this time, I just lift up Brother Roger to you, Father God, as our interim pastor. And I thank you so much for the privilege it is to have a relationship with him and get to know him, Father God, and know that he is a man of God and he is called here to Hillcrest Baptist Church, Lord, to lead us in this time of interim. And I pray, Lord, that you would just direct him through your Holy Spirit and every move and every word and everything that he does and says, Father God, would be glorifying to you and would take this church to a place of that you want us to go, Father God. Help us as a church, Lord, to be obedient as well and pray and lift up Brother Roger as well as the deacon body each and every day, Father God, as we strive to do your will each and every day. Father, we love you and we praise you, and it's in Christ's holy name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Love y'all. Appreciate you so much. God bless you. Love you. Appreciate you. Thank you. Appreciate you. Love you. Thank you. Take your Bibles and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I have not found a better way to begin a sermon without, but by those words, take your Bible. Amen? I ain't got anything to say. Sorry. The Bible's got a lot to say. Amen? And the only thing good about any message is how much Bible's in it and how much the Holy Spirit's in it and how much prayer's over it. In praying the last several weeks about what to preach in the beginning, as we're in a pilgrimage, by the way. You know, it's a good Bible word. It means a journey. Life is a pilgrimage. Amen? We're on a pilgrimage to heaven. And pilgrim is a Bible term for the Christian. It's in the Bible. We're strangers and pilgrims, Hebrews 11. So I'm a pilgrim, just like those pilgrims came over from England seeking religious freedom. And America was based upon the beliefs in the beginning of those wonderful pilgrim people. We've certainly got away from that. So we're in a pilgrimage here, specifically at Hillcrest Baptist Church, toward the next chapter. I thank God for Brother Jerry. Love him so much. Known him 20 years. Ever since he came here, he and I were good friends, have been good friends, and precious wife Rhonda, and all that he has led you to do, and other great pastors you've had. Your grandfather, Kathy, I think, was pastor here. He used to call you down in church if you didn't act right, I heard. But so all the great history. Do you realize, Brother Joe, that 60 years next week, this church will be... Next week, this church will be 60 years old. Did you know that? I know you do because you told me to read the history, and I did it this week. 60 years. God put this faith. Brother Jerry told me something anybody here that can do geology and measurements, he says this is the highest point geographically in the city of Clarksville in Montgomery County. I wish somebody who's really smart would look that up and verify that. I'd like to tell everybody that. Amen? We're at the high. I'm not going to say it publicly till somebody that's smart says yes. So y'all check that out, okay? Somebody out there's got the gift to be able to do that. So in praying about this, the Lord, I believe, led me over the last several weeks, and I've been studying 1 Corinthians for 3 weeks in preparation for this beginning message. There are two reasons why this letter jumps out of the book. Is one, we know so much about its founding. And secondly, we know more about this church and the inner workings of this church than any other of the churches in the New Testament. We've got two books with chapters with like 12 different church issues they had. Now, we know about the issue in Philippi between Euodias and Syntyche. That's about all we know about Philippi. But 1 Corinthians, if we study this, the Word of God's going to guide us and will help us as we prepare for the next pastor. We want to be ready. I love the goal that's, Lisa, I guess you did this, you had in the bulletin, or somebody, whoever did those screens, said, so many was in Sunday school last week, 126. On the way to 200. I thank you for that. That's going to be our first goal, Lord willing, to get to 200 one Sunday soon. So I'll talk to the deacons about setting a high attendance day for that. And always work with the deacons. Praise the Lord. They're there for a reason. Thank God. And so we've got some ideas and things that we will follow. We want them to be led of the Spirit. But as we look at 1 Corinthians, there's so much in here that will keep us from falling into a ditch or getting off the right path. So the title of the series is Keeping the Church on Course. That's the title of this sermon, title of the series, and we'll follow that because that's what Paul's doing. He's keeping the Corinthian church on course because they had so many problems. Just imagine, they had someone, this is horrible, but it's pretty 21st century, a man and his son cohabitating with the same woman. Now that's as bad as it gets. That's in the Bible, so I can talk about it. It's in there. They had Christians suing Christians. How terrible. Still an issue today. Still an issue today. So we'll see many other things in Corinth that will help us as we deal with the problems that come up in life. So with that in mind, let me read the first 9 verses. This is the Word of God, 1 Corinthians 1. I won't make you stand, but sit up real straight, okay? All right. Take a deep breath. Pay attention. Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother, under the church of God which is at Corinth, to them which are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all them in every place who call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything you are enriched by Him, in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, and that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and the same judgment. For it has been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. God bless the reading of His sacred and holy word. So we read all the way to the first problem we're going to face. And this basically is the umbrella over which the whole book is written to keep the church, notice verse 9, perfectly joined together. That's the purpose of this book. To keep the church on course, that we would be perfectly joined together with a unity of mind, the same judgment. No divisions. No divisions in terms of gospel and in terms of ministry. We all have opinions about life and favorite football teams and baseball teams and all that. Here he's talking about spiritually. There's no division about doctrine or about mission. That's the kind of unity we're talking about. So let's look at this, and most of the points begin with a C. Let's get all three in verse. We're going to verse 1, and we're going to have three C's: conversion, call, and confidence, if you're taking notes. First of all, we see a conversion. Paul, that's a good way to begin your letters. Instead of saying, "Dear Corinth," he puts his name first. That way he's identified. Paul. Now that was Saul. He was converted. He was converted on the road to Damascus. God saved him. God intercepted him. God knocked him down. Has God ever knocked you down? God ever took you to the woodshed and give you a spanking? The Bible says if you're His child, He'll do that. Now, Paul was always the most stubborn. Matter of fact, the Bible says he's a pattern. That is an example that everything Paul did as Saul was magnified. Was he a sinner? Chief of sinners. Did Christ die for him? Yes. Did Paul run from Him? Paul ran from Him. Paul was full of hatred. Paul was accessory to murder. He held the coats of the men that stoned Stephen, first Christian martyr, recorded in Acts 7. And yet God saved him. He's a pattern that if God, hallelujah, are you listening? If God can save Saul of Tarsus, God can save you. Praise the Lord. Say amen to that. You're not too bad to be saved. You may be too good to be saved. That is, you think you're too good. But a Christian's a sinner saved by grace. Amen. Then we see a call. We see call to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. So Paul is an apostle. He's sent by God. The word apostle is literally meant to mean one sent. Let's see if I can read part of 1 Corinthians 9. You listen. He's defending it. One of the things that happened up is people later in Corinth is they began to reject him as an apostle. That's how bad it got. I know this would never happen at Hillcrest because I feel your love, but the devil can get in there. Paul was the one that led them to Christ, and in 2 Corinthians, Paul said, "The more I love you, the less you love me." Oh, does that hurt like a knife in the heart that could happen in a church fellowship? But it did. But Paul endured it. It's to show us not only what to do, but what not to do. And so in 1 Corinthians 9, he defends his apostleship saying, am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord? He said, if I be not an apostle, I am to you. You are the seal of my apostleship. So there were basically two things, three perhaps, that marked an apostle. They've seen Jesus Christ in the flesh. They have the authority to write Scripture. And they founded the first churches before they had the Bible. Now, why are the apostles important? Because the Bible says the church is built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. And the book of Acts was a transition book, right? From basically the crucifixion of Christ to about 70 or 80 AD to the end of the century. We didn't have a New Testament. Didn't get the full New Testament till about 95 or 100 when John wrote Revelation, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and Gospel of John. So they were dependent upon the apostles. John was the last apostle. Not a substitute, but before they had the written New Testament, they had the testimony and the doctrine of the apostles. So the apostles were very important. They had false apostles out there, and the Holy Spirit knocked them down. So when we have the New Testament, it's just as good as having the Apostle Paul up here. Say amen. Amen. Because here is the doctrine of the apostles and prophets. So, there are a couple of applications there. Paul was an apostle. When you have the Bible, you've got the word of the apostles. And with all due respect, there are no apostles today on earth. You may see someone, I saw this person on TV say they're an apostle. Well, you can put liar next to them. They're not an apostle. They may be just misled, misguided, but there are churches that do have this doctrine that you still have apostles. No, that means you could have a new scripture. We're not going to get any new scripture. We got the Bible. Praise the Lord. I got the Bible. And Erasmus, that great man who, I won't go into all the history, but kind of came the morning star of the Protestant Reformation, said, when you have the Bible, you've got a more trustworthy word than if you thought you had a vision of Jesus. Amen. I don't need a vision. I don't need dreams anymore. God communicated by those before we had the Bible. I've got the Bible. Praise God. Trust the Word of God. And then we see a confidence. He said, by the will of God. It's good to be in the will of God, isn't it? He said, I'm converted, I'm called, I have confidence. I'm in the will of God. Listen to these verses. The world passes away, the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God shall abide forever. Jesus said, Hebrews 10, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. John 4, Jesus said, my food is to do the will of him that sent me. And the Ephesus church, when they could not persuade Paul from going to Rome, said, the will of the Lord be done. And then for us, this is the will of God, even your sanctification. We ought to always be deferring to the will of God. Are you in the will of God? That's a big question, isn't it? It almost would sound presumptuous for you to say, I'm in the will of God. Well, Paul could say that. I think there's a sense in which we all ought to be able to say, concerning my relationship to Christ, concerning my call to serve in my church, and concerning my local church, I'm in the will of God. Concerning my life as a single adult or a married adult or a formerly married adult or whatever, or what, a widow, I'm in the will of God. I wouldn't ask you, and I don't think the Bible would say that you would say, I'm perfect in the will of God. No, none of us are sinless. We're not sinless, but we're just supposed to sin less, amen, as we go along. You won't lose that sin nature till you see Jesus. Hallelujah. A lot of things about heaven I'm looking forward to. One of them is no longer being a sinner. I'm saved completely. Totally, I'm saved now, but I'm still in this old sinful, dying body. But one day, no sin nature. And to live with all of you, you won't have a sin nature either. That makes me happy to think about too. And so, he was in the will of God. Are you in the will of God? Another thing that is on my heart, and it has to do with this interim. Are you in the will of God where you are in church? Well, yes, if you're, I hope all you Hillcrest people will say, I know it's the will of God for me to be here. And don't go looking around, we need to visit that church, we need to visit that church. I want you to, if you're going to ever visit another church and think about leaving during this interim, you come talk to me first, okay? Because I get to sign the release letter, okay? I want you to look in me in the eye and say, it's the will of God that I leave. God may do that, but you shouldn't just be wishy-washy about your church membership. A church membership's a lot like a marriage. Amen? Oh, it's not quite as binding as a marriage, but it is a very solemn covenant. A marriage is a covenant before God. Church membership is a covenant before God. And you don't leave that any covenant that's made before God for a light reason. Now, apply it another way. Since I don't know everybody here, I'm going to be talking to some of you, and you'll say, how'd you know that about me? Just because I know that's the way it is on Sunday morning. If you're here and you don't have a church home, you're not in the will of God. You hurt my feelings. Well, I didn't mean to. But if you are a Christian, you should have a church home. And you should have a home church. And pray about that. And if God leads you to Hillcrest Baptist Church, I can tell you these are the sweetest, lovingest folks you'll ever see. And they work together so well. And so far, I hadn't found any cantankerous people yet. So praise God. But having said that, are you in the will of God? Now let's go to the next things we see. We see another person. We only see one time in the Bible. And Sosthenes, our brother, unto the church of God which is at Corinth. So let's talk about converts and companions. So we've seen conversion called confidence. Now converts and companions, then we'll get to the church and we'll come to the close of the message. Converts and companions. This word Sosthenes, I've enjoyed getting to know him better. Only time he's in the New Testament, Sosthenes. Now, we won't take the time to turn to Acts chapter 17 or 18. Let me give you a two-minute history of the start of the church. Paul was on his second missionary journey, and he is following up on the places he went in the first missionary journey. Derbe, Lystra, you know all the places in Acts 13 and 14. Then he went to the Jerusalem conference in Acts 15. And there they had the first great church council over this question. Does a Gentile, that's you and me, by the way, unless you're Jewish. It's amazing, every church I've ever been in, you will have somebody who is a Hebrew. Praise God for you. If you are, I'd like to meet you and get to know you better. But you and I are Gentiles. That means anybody that's not a Jew. And you know what they thought about the old Orthodox Jews called Gentiles? What? Dogs. That was very politically incorrect, wasn't it? That's what they felt like. And so one of the great things that the Holy Spirit did was say to Paul and Peter, especially Peter, when Cornelius, a Gentile, a Roman, a soldier, was converted and recorded in Acts chapter 10, and Paul was invited to dinner. Catfish. Bacon. I can't eat that. I'm a Jew. And God said, what I've cleansed, let no man call common. He said something else I hope all of us will remember. There is no respect of persons with God. Racial superiority is out the window. There's no respect persons with God. And so Sosthenes lived in Corinth. So Paul has now gotten the freedom because the church council decided Gentiles do not have to become Jews in order to be saved. Say, well, we know that now, but they didn't. Praise God, it liberated Paul. He said, I'm going back. So he retraced his steps, and then he said, I want to go to Asia, which was up toward Russia, China, India. And he stood at Troas there on what's now Turkey. And God gave him a vision, and he saw a man that said, come over to Macedonia and help us. That's Europe. That's Greece. And Paul turned, the Holy Spirit forbade him to go to Asia. Well, we could talk a lot about that thought, couldn't we? The Holy Spirit forbade him to go to Asia. Interestingly, though, at the end of this journey, he ended up in Ephesus for 2 years, which is Asia. God still got him there. You just had to follow the Lord, amen? And he went to Philippi. You have the first convert. I mentioned this Wednesday night. Who was the first convert in Europe? Lydia, a dress sales lady. She was a seller of purple. She was upwardly mobile. She was from Asia. And she and some others were saved. Then Paul got put in jail for casting out demons. And then the church was born in Europe. The fact that God sent Paul to Europe instead of Asia determined the fact that Western civilization would be the cradle of Christianity for 1,000 years and more. Is that amazing? Just amazing. And all the revivals that have come out of Germany, England, and America, the gospel went west. It still went east, but its bastion became Western Europe and America, and now Korea is a great bastion and others. Praise God. So, who's Sosthenes? Well, Paul finally, after Philippi, he went down to Thessalonica, Berea. He went to Athens. And then after Athens, he went to the city of Corinth, and God stopped him. Corinth was a wicked, 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 wicked city. Read Romans 1 about all the sexual wickedness that Paul wrote about in Romans 1, from homosexuality and all the other things, which homosexuality is as old as Sodom. Amen? It's nothing. It's, and always, I say this with tears in my eyes, the last step on the downward path of the nations over the millennia has been the normalization and acceptance of sodomy. That's homosexuality. We need to teach our young people that. We need to put the fear of God in them about it. We need to put the fear of God in them and in us. So, gets to Corinth, and God says, stay here. I have many people in this city. Praise God. I've got some pastor friends pastoring in Las Vegas whose churches are going great guns. Praise God. So God saves people in Las Vegas, and God can save people in Corinth. And so, you go read it in chapter 17 and 18 of Acts, but Sosthenes was the head of the synagogue. Now, Paul always started with the synagogues. Why? Romans 1:16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, or is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. What's the next phrase? To the Jew first, then to the Greek. Wherever Paul went, he didn't do this in Athens. He started at the Mars Hill. He said, I'm never going to do that again. I'm going to start at the synagogues. And there are people that got saved, and then they threw Sosthenes out. He was the head of the synagogue. They threw him out, and Sosthenes became a companion on the missionary trips. Isn't that beautiful? Only time we see him there. Now let's look to the church of God at Corinth. Now let's talk about the church, and that's where we'll close up. It's a local church, Corinth. 95 times out of the 100 times the word church is mentioned in the New Testament, refers to a local church. Amen? Isn't that interesting? Only about 5 times does it talk about the church universal, which there is a church universal. We won't have Baptist, Methodist, you know all that, in heaven. We'll be born-again Christians. Those names and labels, however, mean something. The name Baptist is an old name. I'm kind of like the proverb. Twice it says, don't throw away the ancient landmark. The word Baptist is an ancient landmark, been around about 500 years, and it symbolizes Bible-believing Christians. So I'm still happy to be called a Baptist Christian. But in heaven, because there's so many different denominations that don't believe the Bible anymore. I want to keep us on target. So having said that, Paul is preaching the gospel there and this local church, and now he's going to tell them what the church is made of. Let's look at this, verse 2. Sanctified, called to be saints. First of all, the church is full of saints. Amen? Go ahead and say amen, because you know some of you don't believe it. But by the way, the word saint, singular, is never in the Bible. Find it. You can't. Because we don't make someone a saint. Saint this, saint that, saint this, saint that. No, we're all saints. What does the word saint mean? Holy one. That's all it means. When you accept Jesus as Savior, His righteousness goes on you. You become holy. How? By the gift of grace. Notice the next word in verse 3. Grace be unto you and peace. That's how you become a saint. You are given grace. You have been saved by grace. You're saved by the gift of grace. Grace is G-R-A-C-E, God's riches at Christ's expense. That's a good definition of grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. Mercy, grace is more than mercy. Mercy is God giving you what you don't deserve. Excuse me, let me start that over. Mercy is not giving you what you deserve. You deserve hell. Grace is God giving you what you don't deserve, heaven. Isn't that great? So grace is more than mercy. I need mercy, but also more than that, need grace. So we are saints, that is, we're to be holy. And the main proof of your Christianity outwardly is that you are walking a holy life. The words, and also the word sanctified is there, if you look in verse 2. Sanctified is a same noun form of hagias, which is the word holy, Hagia Sophia, Church of Wisdom, Istanbul. You've heard of that long, long 1,500-year-old church. It means saint, holy. Sanctified means that you're set apart for God to be like Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. By His grace. Then let's read on. This church, the part of salvation is giftedness. We're sanctified. We're given grace. Then we're gifted for ministry. Look at verse 4 and following. I thank God for the grace, that word means gift, given to you there, and everything you are enriched. These gifts that you mentioned to the children, these are gifts. I'll tell you a quick story. My first church ever pastor had Mr. Charlie Wilson. And I made a mistake once and tried to call on him for prayer at the offering. He went, I said, okay, I get it. I should have asked. He didn't have the gift of talking in public. But when we went to paint the steeple, and no one wanted to get up there and shimmy the top of that steeple and paint it, Brother Charlie shimmied that steeple and painted it because he had a love and a gift of helps to do that. Well, praise God. I love seeing the gifts of the Spirit moving in your church. Praise God for that. You're enriched in all things and all utterance, all knowledge. So you have gifts of teachers, utterance, knowledge, people who know the Word of God. A Sunday school teacher is a great gift to a church. A children's worker is a great gift to the church. Anything you do to help someone in the name of Jesus in the church is a gift. Verse 6, that the testimony of Jesus was confirmed in you so that you become behind and no gift. Now they're going to get in chapter 12, 13, 14, which we'll get to whenever we get to it. They're having a little argument about the gift of tongues. And we're going to talk about tongues, frankly and honestly, at that time. And they were misinterpreting and misusing, misapplying, and had ignorance about the gift of tongues. And we'll see what all that's all about later. Then verse 7, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So there's, I give the word security. The church is sanctified, saints. They're full of grace. They're gifted for ministry. And they're secure. We are secure in the hand of God. We're waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, verse 8, who shall confirm you. That means secure you till you sin and lose your salvation. Is that what it says? No. What does it say? Who shall confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless. See, we're not ever to be sinless, but we're to try to be blameless. That no one could bring an accusation against you. You're blameless until the day of Jesus Christ. You know, Luther, I love old Martin Luther. He wasn't perfect. He said some things I wish he hadn't said. He said about 1,000 things I'm glad he did say. We're not here to worship any man. We'll talk about that too next sermon. Even Luther had faults. But Luther said there are only 2 days in the Christian's life. I said, oh boy, what's that mean? What are they? Today and that day. Amen. Hallelujah. I got today. I'm looking for that day when Jesus comes or when I see Jesus. Hallelujah. You only got 2 days, today and that day. He said, I'm going to confirm you blameless until the day of Jesus Christ. Then we have faithful fellowship, and that's where we'll close. Verse 9. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship, the partnership of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And He closes it out. What an introduction to what a church is. Amen? That's Hillcrest. Go back and read that in your devotional this week, that we are called unto the faithful by a faithful God. God is not finished with Hillcrest Baptist Church yet. I won't do this every Sunday, but say amen. All right. God has a great big plan. You know, I was pastor at First Baptist Church 20 years. And 60 years ago, next week, First Baptist Church was used to plant this church. I feel so much of a call to be involved in this that we're involved in. My life's invested in that church, and I hope we'll be invested in the right way with you. But He's going to be faithful the next 60 years. We're in partnership, fellowship with God. In 1 Corinthians 3:10, it says, we're laborers together with God. Now, tonight, we're going to go from the heavenlies to down where the rubber meets the road. We're going to talk about the first church fuss they're having. You mean a church that all the good things God just said about them is going to have some problems? Well, I want to ask you a question. Have you and your wife, all the years you've lived, never had a disagreement? Well, now y'all all smile. Of course you love her. She loves you. But you've had many disagreements. So Christians need to learn how to handle the issues, and that's what we're going to try to do in this study. Well, we have a wonderful Savior. We have a Savior who died on the cross for our sins, shed His precious royal blood. He was beaten. He was spit upon. He was hit by fists. They nailed His hands and His feet. They mocked Him. They gave Him vinegar and gall to drink. And then at that noon hour, He said, my God, why hast Thou forsaken Me? That's the only one of the seven sayings that's mentioned twice in the Gospels. And what happened in that time? Well, we'll never fully understand in heaven. I don't know if we'll fully understand in heaven. We'll just worship it, worshiping. God the Father, in holiness, turned His back for a moment on God the Son and placed the wrath of God upon His Son for our sins. I can't understand that. I'm unworthy. So are you. But then, if you look at those seven words, the first word was, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. And He did say, and then He did mention the word Father again. He's in fellowship with the Father there in the first word. And then the middle word, He says, my God, He's talking to God in general, not His Father. God had become His judge. And then the very last words, Father, into Thy hands I commit my spirit. Back in fellowship. You and I can trust God that He will be our Father to the very end, because just as the wrath of God was placed upon Jesus, all the love of God is in Jesus. But God commendeth His love toward us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. If you've never accepted Jesus as Savior, come forward. We'll be here at the front. If you've never been baptized as a believer, you need to do that. I'm looking at you. If you've not been baptized, you're outside the will of God. He loves you. You need to be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If you're looking for a church home, you come. Let's pray. Father, thy will be done. Bless this invitation. We give it to you. Let Jesus be glorified. Bless us in these days ahead as we trust and obey in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's stand and sing Trust and Obey. And this will be our song of invitation, a song of appeal. I'll be standing here at the front. Deacons will be here to assist if God leads.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. Let us do His good will. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil it doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delight of His worth until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
It's just such a blessing to be with God's people. May the Lord bless you and guide you through every decision you have to make today, and may tomorrow morning when you have to get up early and go to work, you just feel the joy of the Lord. Amen. Best thing to do is just get up and do it. And the Lord's with you. And it's a joy to pray with all of you from time to time. And I'll tell you one other, just sit down a moment, that'll be fine. This is my testimony day. When I was 17 years old, after thinking a long time about it, my father had died 3 or 4 years earlier, and I was kind of realized the brevity of life, and I love the Lord, and I felt called to preach. And when I told my mother I was going to, "Mother, I'm going to be a preacher," you know what she did? She started crying. I said, "Well, what is the matter with you?" I didn't say it like that, believe me. And she said, "Oh, churches give pastors such a hard time. I don't want you to have to go through that." And being so full of myself, I said, "Oh, Mother, they're all going to like me. Don't worry about it." But I found out they didn't all like me. So, but she, after I surrendered, she said something to me that has been a north star to my life. She was very, very active in church all her life. She was raised up under the preaching of R.G. Lee. How about that? Payday Someday, Bellevue Baptist Church. Her house was, excuse the golf analogy, a nine iron from Bellevue Baptist Church. And she said, "Brother," she said, she didn't call me Brother Roger. She said, "Roger, George W. Truett was pastor at First Baptist Church, Dallas. And I heard him say one time that he prayed for a pastor's heart. Since you're going to be a pastor, you need to pray for a pastor's heart." I said, thank you. And since age 17, I've been praying for a pastor's heart. I think God has given me most of that prayer. I love to pastor the church. I love the church. I love you. I love people in the church. Nothing would make me happier than to just be a part of what you're doing the next few months and see God keep on keeping on. So we got to stay together. Amen. It's like Benjamin Franklin said when they signed the Declaration of Independence against King George. He said, if we don't all hang together, we're all going to hang separately. Amen. That's a good little American history there. So let's hang together. Let's stay together. Go forward. We're going to pray. Now, when I become a pastor, I kind of set a goal or two and do a few things. I'm not as young as I used to be, Bobby. But we're going to set a goal of 200 in Sunday school. Let's figure out a date. Lord willing, we'll figure out a date, and I'll talk to Lisa about that. And boy, I'd love to see that debt go down on that building over there before that pastor comes. We'll have to pray about that one. But that's the main thing is spiritual. Amen? Spiritual. Let's be holy people before a holy God. I don't know what to do as interim pastor. You don't know what to do, but we know someone who does. And if we'll stay close to Him, follow Him, stay it together, love one another, He's going to guide us. And it's a pilgrimage. It's not a 100-yard dash. It's not even a marathon. That only takes a day. It's a pilgrimage, which is a long journey. But at the end, God's will be done. Brother Deacon, Chairman, anything else? Let's pray. Now may the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do God's will, working in us that which is well-pleasing in His sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord be glory forever and ever, world without end. Amen and amen. You're dismissed.